prize, raise high for the toast. This is our moment, always on the grind till the sun come on us. They can never control us, running for the prize, raise high for the toast. This is our moment. The might of Tonga and the very impressive UK team. Following that, it is the playoff for third and fourth. This should be a beauty. Fiji, who came so close to making the final, losing 6-5 in that semi-final, will take on the might of Australia. And then, it is all up who will be crowned the first ever International Defence Force champions. 1 o'clock this afternoon, France take on the Defence Fern. Yes, France take on New Zealand. In commentary, Stephen Harris, the voice of the Taniwha. Stephen, look, it's been a remarkable 3 weeks of rugby. I know we've both been just blown away by the standard. When you look back, what have been some of the memories for you? What's impressed you the most?
Oh, listen, a lot of these young ladies, no matter which country they're from, putting their hand up and just showing that they can actually play at a higher level, and some can take their game to another level.
Yeah. Now, one thing is just to see the growth of women's rugby. We've got a Women's Rugby World Cup going on at the moment. Let's talk about Fiji. I mean, how good have they been?
Oh, listen, fantastic. We know they've got a rich history in sevens, but to see a female team out here playing 15s, playing in the style of rugby that we know what they're capable of, and boy, they show that when they get it right, they can score from anywhere on the paddock.
Well, all the Pacific Island teams play the way I think William Webb Ellis dreamed of the game being played when he first picked up a soccer ball and ran with it and the game of rugby was invented. Now, we're not going to have a live stream of this, but we are going to bring you the national anthems and the teams coming out onto the park. We are going to have, for 5th and 6th, Tonga up against the United Kingdom, contrasting styles. What do the Tongans need to do if they're to get up over this UK team?
Oh, I think they need to play abrasively, the style which they know. They're a very, very solid pack. They play in a very small channel, shall we say, but they've got to get their support players close to those players when they do get over the advantage line, get their offloading game going, because that's their strength.
Yeah, and set piece, it's been, I guess it's been mixed fortunes for all teams. We've seen New Zealand in the first up game struggling at set piece. They've corrected it. For Tonga, they've certainly got the size, but they're going to need to just make some adjustments technically if they're to be on par with this very good United Kingdom team.
Yeah, been a real issue for the Tongans against the better teams in this particular competition. The UK team, they will be good, like any European team, good over the ball. All their structures are very good. And boy, they've shown they've got some talent out wide to hurt the Tongans.
Yep. And Stephen, and we're going to do a little bit more on this shortly. First game up this morning that will be streamed, it is the playoff for third and fourth. Fiji take on Australia. The first time these two teams played, Fiji put 60 odd points on the Australians. You've spoken with the Australians. What did they put that down to?
Oh, they reckoned the headspace wise they weren't here. They probably still had one foot on the plane, and it probably showed in that result. So they've got a real point to prove against this Fijian team. They are still dark, let me give you the tip.
Yeah, we saw a much improved performance from the Australians in the next game against the UK. They tackled. And let's, when it comes to championship play, defence will ultimately win you the game. How important is that for Tonga as well, making those first up tackles?
Oh, listen, Australia defensively are a good team. It's basically kept them in a couple of games, maybe that game against the UK, if I recall. But they will need to be right on that game in their particular area. They've got some really good individual players in their side. Ross in the middle row has looked a really good player. Kavua, the number eight. They've got talent, no question.
And of course, plenty of pressure today also on the officials. And it's great that we've got the officials from the Defence Force as well. So this is all inclusive. This is very much about the Army. It's very much about the Navy and the Air Force. So pathways, not just as players, but also as officials.
Oh, listen, huge. Why wouldn't you want to join one of the forces at this moment? You get paid to play rugby, or you can get paid to officiate rugby. Doesn't get any better.
Okay, now we're not too far away from welcoming the first two teams onto the field, and we will take you through their national anthems, and it is two very proud nations, Tonga and the United Kingdom. Just looking at the weather conditions today, it's probably the best conditions we've seen. Any real advantage for either side?
No, not really. There's not a lot of wind around here. Yes, there's a little bit of a southerly, but I don't think it's going to affect the play too much. It's perfect, and we know this field here, synthetic field, so we don't have to worry about underfoot conditions. It's going to be great.
Okay, we're now going to welcome the two teams for this plate final onto the number one ground here. It is the United Kingdom and Tonga.
What is it called? Glory or welcome to final day here at College Rifles. We've got Tonga taking the field alongside the UK for the plate final today. Kick-off time is at 10:30. Beautiful day for some finals footy. Can we please be upstanding for the national anthems?
Oh, wonderful to see, and how proud are the Tongan nation, a nation very much built on faith as well. To the United Kingdom, well, a slight adjustment for them, of course, with the passing of the Queen these days. It is now God Save the King. Well, as myself and Stephen Harris have alluded to, it's been a remarkable three-week tournament as we count down to these final matches on this final day. Let's take a moment now to look back and reflect on what has been an extraordinary tournament.
bring Goliath on. No giant, I ain't going fire on. Catch a fade, you are wrong. I'm gone, y'all can catch the wave that I am on. I am icon, y'all are wide born. Think that I'm a wrecking sideball, so ain't nothing to it though. This is on me, ain't got much to do with who you know. Keeping it true to form 10 L's into a milli though. But they already knew that those farewell to your opinions know that he is so. This is all me, ain't got much to do with who you know. Keeping it true to form, but they already knew that your opinions know. Take seats. I hate to be the one say I ain't keep a hunt. Dread you changing me majorly. They pay to see the way that we come and compete. It's clear to me you talking off and off of me. You say the least, you better believe we been through the ringer. We're through to them arenas. Menu that's for dinner or the ringer. Five fingers and the difference that's between us. Read it written in subpoenas. So in other words, the game that needs we just reinvigorated. You little agitated. Had to get them activated. No kind of active, ain't it? Turn my occupation got me agitated. But I'm obligated later. Conversating be an understatement just to say that this is all me, ain't got much to do with who you know. Yeah, keep it true to form, but they already knew that though, so here we go.
Well, a remarkable tournament so far. Wonderful highlights, wonderful tries. Tries that, well, just reflect the way the Southern Hemisphere love to play. It's been very much a competition where it's not just been dominated by the forwards, it's very much been the 15-man game. Well, Stephen Harris in the background, we've got the mighty Fiji, unlucky not to make the final. They're going to come up against Australia. What do the Fijians need to do if they get one foot on that podium?
Well, I think emotionally they just need to get pick themselves off the floor. If you recall, they lost that game pretty much in their semi-final in the last minute, where the previous week before the emotions were a little bit different. So they've got to park that up, get back on the paddock, and then basically find that form that they started this tournament with.
Yeah, and Fiji, well, their talent, it's been spread right around the world. They just play with such flair. And the defence Ferns have a Fijian player, or a couple of Fijian players in their team. The fullback for the defence Ferns, just simply known as Toots. Now, we caught up with you prior to this tournament alongside Clementine Varea to get their thoughts on what this means for the defence forces, what this means for women's rugby. Well, Clementine Toots of Samoan descent, of Fijian descent, playing for New Zealand's Defence Forces. This is what makes this tournament so remarkably unique, this camaraderie, the United Nations coming together.
Yeah, absolutely. This is an amazing opportunity that we've been able to bring in all the other Defence Forces from the different countries and Defence Women to play a sport that we love.
And Toots, what have you learned about her culture?
I've learned that the Samoan culture is very respectful, like just across the board, very well-mannered, cultured people, yeah.
And what Fijian culture have you brought to this environment?
I think I've brought the morale for the team, as well as the other girls, but yeah, we've brought the fun with us today.
It's great that you're actually going to be, while you're going to be wearing a New Zealand jersey, you're going to be taking on some of the Pacific Island nations. How's that going to feel?
Amazing, I think. It'll be cool to front up to the countries that we call home and our motherland, so yeah, it'll be exciting, yeah.
And of course Fiji, well, they love their sevens and they love their rugby. Big responsibility.
Yeah, that is a big responsibility. I'm actually quite scared, but it would be a great opportunity to see how we react towards each other in different sides.
Why do they call Clementine the smiling assassin?
Because she's always smiling, but when she's on the field, she's there to kill.
That's a very good way of putting it.
Well done. And does Toots bring the Fijian flair?
Oh, absolutely. She's a hype on her own. Yeah, absolutely. And you haven't seen the flair tonight or today, but hopefully in one of the games you'll see the flair with her afro out running in the wind.
What's it like doing the New Zealand haka, coming from Samoa and coming from Fiji?
It's an amazing feeling. It's an honour and it's a privilege, yeah, for me.
Yeah, it really is. There's a different... what we say here in New Zealand, mana, that comes with it, a certain strength that you get from the girls around you while you're doing the haka itself.
When you first joined the Defence Forces, did you ever think this would be possible?
Yeah, personally I didn't think that it was an option that we could be here playing sport in the Defence Force. I just thought, serve your country, and that was about it.
And your origins in Samoa, where are you from?
From Lefanga. So that's in the backyards, and then in Apia, Vaiusu and Vailoa.
And who were your inspirations growing up watching rugby?
Oh, it'd be the All Blacks, Richie McCaw, for me, and yeah, that's such a standard answer, eh?
It's a great answer.
Yeah, I'll stick with that then.
Okay. Mine would have to be, I'm originally from Fiji, my dad's south side, Kandavu, and my mum's west side, Nandrunga. And growing up, well, that's a really hard one, actually. I would say Joe Rikidoko, definitely.
Oh, yes.
Left-hand winger. And Jonah Lomu, of course.
Yeah, Jonah Lomu, of course.
Okay, a message for the people of Samoa.
Fatalo fatu leo mai mole nei tula, fafteite lava mole langolongo ina o mato talonga, fafteite.
And for the people across Fiji watching this live through Pacifica Television?
Wenaka wakalebu, nanomuni waitokoni. Wenaka.
That is just gold. Clementine Varea. They call her the smiling assassin. Look out when she does come off the bench a little bit later on this afternoon for that final against the French. As for Toots, I tell you what, if you are France, you do not kick to her, because she can cut you to pieces from anywhere on the park. Well, Stephen Harris, the Australians, they come up against a team that did a demolition on them in the very first round of this tournament, but they have progressed nicely. What type of rugby do they need to be playing this morning? Do they need to play conservatively? Do they play the 15-man game? How loose can they afford to be against the might of Fiji?
Yeah, well, that's the first thing. They can't really kick the ball away. They need to hold onto the ball for long periods and just create their own sort of pressure. Want to see a little bit more of the skipper, Sarah Reardon, because I think she's been a little quiet in this tournament. She has got some skills, and I just want to see a lot more of that outside back division from Australia.
Yeah, and they do have some very big, hard ball carrying forwards who have that ability to get across that advantage line, and that's where the likes of Fiji are going to have to be smart, make those tackles, but boy, they're going to need to get their cleaners in.
Oh, listen, totally agree with you. Listen, Australia, they're not too bad at set piece if they can put a bit of pressure on Fiji, get their game going, and I like the look of their lock, Ross. I think she's been one of the players of this particular tournament. She seems to be one of their key carriers in this Australian team.
Well, this tournament, it's the first time it's been held. The vision is for every 4 years in the country that hosts the Women's Rugby World Cup, this will run alongside of it or just after it. Tournament director is Major John Liddell. We caught up with him prior to the tournament starting. Major John Liddell, How challenging has the last 12 weeks been in terms of bringing this tournament together?
Yeah, heck of a lot of work. Normally you'd like 12 months notice to get all this done, right from sending invitations out to about 10 or 12 nations, getting the teams organised, getting the travel here, the accommodation, the rations, and particularly the strategic engagement part of it, the leverage, the communications, the streaming of the matches. Yeah, it's been a busy period, but we're looking pretty good.
Yeah, and lovely to have the likes of the French and the English here, Australia, and of course a large part of the Pacific Islands. What was the response like? How has the response been?
Oh, it was really brilliant. Every nation that we approached wanted to come. A couple just couldn't fit it in with only 12 weeks or 3 months to go, but they were busting keen to get here. A lot of work. You know, we're a small defence force, but when you think of Tonga, Fiji, Vanuatu, PNG, they're smaller again. So getting their teams together, 15 aside, and getting them down here was a big issue. And it's been an amazing effort by everyone involved to get them all here.
From the defence services, what are you wanting to get out of this tournament?
There is a big part of it is the strategic engagement. Militaries cooperate all around the world without any fanfare or sort of advertising. So we all know each other, and just being engaged with each other is a very important thing for New Zealand in general. Then you go down to the sport itself. All defence forces place a high value on sport, particularly in rugby. Well, you've got to be brave to play rugby. You've got to be physically fit. You've got to be resilient. You've got to be a good team player. And you've also got to be capable of leadership. So from every point of view that you can think of, it's a very positive thing for New Zealand to have done this.
And women's rugby, a lot of sports, but it's focused around women's rugby.
This one is. We obviously engage in other sports overseas as well, but at the moment it's women's rugby. This is the first 15-a-side that's ever been played. We'll be looking to carry this forward in the future to be in a bigger and better tournament. What's happening in the military is paralleling what's happening outside. We've gone from something like a few thousand women players to 27,000 in New Zealand. That's happening in these other countries as well, so it's a growing sport. You know, it's exciting to be involved in.
And maybe a message for young people watching this?
A defence career offers many varied challenges, and one of them is to be able to continue in sport at any given level. It's a fabulous part of it to be able to keep fit and play competitive sports. So rugby is just one of them. Very exciting again.
Yeah, great conversation there with Major John Liddell. Well, we've got plenty of visitors around at the venue for our very final day of this Defence Forces competition. And I'll introduce these two people to the right of me in one moment, but we'll start with our Manuhiri, our visitor from Australia, our attache for Australian rugby, and her name is Esther Sue. Nā mahoro mai.
Hey, thank you so much for having us here today.
Esther, tell me a little bit about your role and what brings you over here.
Yeah, so I'm actually the Australian National Operations Manager for the Australian Defence Force Women's Team. And we're over here to participate in the inaugural International Defence Rugby Championships hosted by the Kiwis.
And listen, how have you found things over here? The hospitality, how the girls are travelling?
Hey, I think like with anything, our trans-Tasman relationship continues to strengthen, and this just further fosters that relationship. And we've been hosted in a way that we've always been received every time we travel over to you guys, with warm and open arms, so it's been great.
And listen, we know how fit a lot of our military personnel are, but we've been mightily impressed with what the girls have put on the paddock. How impressed have you been with your girls, the team itself?
Yeah, I've been extremely proud with what they've achieved. 5 weeks of pure rugby training, which is probably a little bit more different to their military employment or day jobs that they have. So the fact that their bodies have held together and they've still got a fighting spirit, can't ask for anything more.
Yes, so these images obviously going around the world. But what do you want to say to maybe a young woman back in Australia looking for a career?
Hey, look, I think prior to this occurring and a couple years ago, you couldn't be what you couldn't see. But now, what an amazing opportunity where we have female military members who are participating full-time in an elite-level rugby competition. And this is exactly what we want to promote, that the difference you bring is the value you can add. And, hey, you can be because you can see it happen. So that's a message I want to give.
Oh, listen, that's fantastic. Now, other visitor just here on the right is a gentleman who's been part of the tournament, Colonel Duncan Roy. Colonel, welcome to have you here.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here.
And listen, just in terms of some of the feedback, some of the games that you've been seeing, you've been enjoying it?
Oh, we've been loving it, loving the quality and loving having a number of countries here to celebrate. you know, post-COVID, as we set this up, it was really important for us to reset what was normal for being in defence and be able to celebrate women in sport, and particularly women in rugby. And it was just too good an opportunity not to link in with the Rugby World Championship, the inaugural Defence Rugby Championship.
Listen, Colonel, how did this all basically come together? Like any plans, they usually all are born together in the boardroom.
Well, we got together and we've been talking about it for a couple of years, and then COVID obviously put paid to that. But then the borders opened in March and we went to our senior leadership and our Chief of Defence Force, Air Marshal Short. We pitched it to him and he said, this sounds like a great idea, a celebrative sport, our partnership within the Pacific and their links to the UK and France and Australia. And we thought we'll put it together, and people have done a great job to turn this around so quickly and run such an awesome tournament.
And listen, we'll talk about some of the games on the field. We've seen some great rugby as well, and I'm going to be a little bit biased here. From a New Zealand point of view, how impressed have you been with the Defence Ferns?
Well, I know this team, and I know they were good, and we've been watching them work really hard and develop. But I think, as Esther said, the opportunity for all the teams to come and spend some weeks together in a camp and work together, we've seen the quality of the rugby build up across the board. Wow. So it's been great.
And of course, the New Zealand team going well, and we've seen how good this Australian team can be in this tournament, Esther, especially your two skippers, Sarah Reardon and Zara Lee.
Yeah, look, there's a lot of pressure on, noting that our first game against Fiji didn't quite go our way, but I think with the passion and drive that we've got and the motivation to take home a win is there to fuel the fire that we've to succeed.
And of course, speaking of Sarah Lee and Sarah Reardon and Zara Lee, we actually caught up with the two girls pre-tournament just to chat about how things would roll along.
How excited are you to be here in New Zealand playing in this Defence Force International Rugby competition?
Yeah, look, the girls are really, really excited. I know we both are very excited to be over here, come across the ditch, and what better place to play some rugby in, I guess, the home of rugby in New Zealand.
How difficult a challenge has it been bringing the girls together in such a short period of time and getting them to gel?
It's always a challenge, but it's always part of what makes it what it is and what makes it such a great experience. So we're getting there, we'll keep building and we'll keep gelling as we go.
What's the message that you want to get out to people around the world regarding the Defence Forces?
I guess that there's more to us than just our daily jobs of, I guess, defending our countries. We're all athletes at the same time and all share a passion no matter what job we're in. So I think that's probably the main thing. And we're women and we love to play rugby.
That's the unique thing, isn't it? You're going to come up against each other on the sports field, but off the field it is very much a community. It's very much a sort of a one team, one dream approach.
Yeah, 100%, and same with the other nations as well. It's good to see the girls from the other teams as well. We've seen them a few times now, so it's good to reconnect there as well.
Have you been reminded about it's been 20-odd years since you've won the Bledisloe Cup? Is that motivation for you to do what the men haven't been able to do?
Oh yeah, definitely. We try not to think about that too much, but luckily we've got the Wallaroos over here to motivate us against the Black Ferns as well. So I guess it's that battle across the ditch all around, so we'll see how we go.
Do you know much about your opposition?
We've versed a few of them, so yes, we know there's some speedy backs and there's some big forwards, but yeah, we'll just wait and see what comes out.
And in terms of establishing a culture, what is the culture within this Australian Defence Force team?
I guess we're still building a culture, and I guess creating a culture that suits us really well. We started in Adelaide when we came into camp a week ago, and we're still moulding that at the moment. But for us, it's more just a family and coming together. We've got a lot of new young girls in, so it's just bringing them up through the ropes and creating, I guess, that family culture that we want and that we can have off the park and most importantly on the park as well.
And what style of rugby are you looking to play?
I don't know. I think we'll have to have a look at our oppositions and make our game plan depending on who we're versing. We'll just have to test and adjust and see what team we're up against.
And that is the trophy that is up for grabs this afternoon for the first ever winner of the Defence Force International Rugby Competition. This is arguably the Defence Force World Cup. John Liddell, we've already played an interview that we did with you prior to this tournament, but man, it is a lovely looking trophy. Congratulations on a remarkable tournament so far. What chance do you give the French of etching their name on this, John?
I've got to be completely unbiased with a comment on that. So we wish both teams a great game, and of course we hope the Kiwis will win, but I won't make any predictions.
Now, John, you're a good man out at Grammar Boy. Rugby was a big part of your life, and you decided that the service is where you wanted to ultimately end up having your career. Just a message to young people out there, why the Defence Forces? What career opportunity? Why?
Well, there's still every good reason. One is to be a good citizen of New Zealand, but there's also the career opportunities are still outstanding. I can't think of any other organisation that offers the training and preparation and qualifications that you can get by joining the Defence Force. Not only serve your country, you'll have a great time playing rugby and sports and getting around the world, but you'll end up leaving the forces with a world-class qualification. So every good reason to consider the defence.
So that is up what's for grabs. Well, Stephen Harris, let's just preview that final this afternoon, because it is France. It is taking on the Defence Ferns. We go back through the history of rugby, mainly on the men's side, because that's arguably where the history is. But 1987, the All Blacks, France, Eden Park. 1999, well, we won't talk about that semi-final. 2011, the men end up beating France again in a closely fought competition to win that World Cup. And it's only apt then, isn't it, that this first ever Defence international competition is played between these two great nations, and now it's a chance for the women to create a legacy.
Well, the good thing is it's not Bastille Day, but it is very close to Guy Fawkes.
We're going to go right back to 1978, aren't we? Bastille Day. You've got a long memory.
Yeah, we have. Listen, I think it'll be a wonderful opportunity. I think the locals be well and truly up for this. They'll want to be the first holder of this particular trophy, and of course for the French, well, they just want to put it on an aircraft and take it back to France, and it'll be the perfect tonic for the pre-Rugby World Cup in 2023.
Yeah, I think when you look at the two teams, maybe the one thing that perhaps the French lack, and that is those big ball carriers out wide in the midfield. They're good at putting the ball through the hands, but they just don't seem to have maybe that one X-factor player. So how do they adjust knowing that? And they will know that.
Oh, listen, I think first of all they have to play to their strength. They have to play to their strengths with very impressive tight head prop Labib. She's probably been the standout tight head in this tournament. But right at the back, I'd like to see them get the ball in the hands of Gourget, the fullback, because she's been very, very good. Looks their best outside back.
Yeah, let's talk about Labib, because she carries brilliantly. You almost need to just pick and go through the middle. Use her in that second or third phase. Draw those New Zealand defenders in. One-on-one, she's going to be very, very hard to beat.
Yeah, listen, I think she probably needs to get a few offloads going, so they need players right off her shoulder, because all of a sudden, if she gets taken in a chop tackle, you bring the likes of Leah Miles, who's been so impressive for this Defence Ferns teams in this comp.
Yeah, let's talk a little bit about this New Zealand team, because you just go out wide, Hayley Hitana just running the ship at first five, and then you go to likes of Cairns and Greg. Boy, what a midfield combination, and considering too that Melania Gregg is just 19 years of age.
Oh, fantastic. From a league background, and it shows with her tackling style. Beautiful chop tackler. Listen, if I was any scout around, and we've had the likes of Willie Walker here, I think round two he was here, you've got to be looking at this kid, because she's actually looking at a career maybe in the NRL as well. But I know the Defence Forces would love to keep her as well. So why not keep her in the Defence Forces, keep her in Aotearoa?
Yeah, but let's also now talk about the Defence Ferns tight five, or their entire forward pack. You've mentioned Liam Miles, but their bench as well. They've got athleticism. But what we don't see in the men's game, we're seeing plenty of, is here. They've got ball-carrying front rowers, which is great to see.
Oh, exactly. No, if you're talking of a tournament team, well, you've already got your tight head in Prayson Labib, and your loose-head prop, Bridget Lake. Well, she started off the bench in the first game, but boy, she's become a permanent fixture in the starting 15. She's been absolutely superb. Christina Seal at lock as well, very, very impressive. And Arapeta, the number eight, also been impressive as well. So they've got it going on.
One thing we haven't seen a lot of, and I wonder whether this may be a tactic and a strategy perhaps of the New Zealand team, we haven't seen a lot of tactical kicking, have we? And we haven't seen a lot of kicking from the base of the scrum.
Yeah, I'd like to, we spoke about that in commentary. I'd like to see a little bit more of that. You can put some pressure on this French back three, especially with a good kicking game. They're just a little bit reluctant to try that. I don't think they're going to change. I think they're going to try and keep it in hand again.
Okay, we're not too far away from welcoming out both Australia and Fiji for this playoff for third and fourth. One more look at this lovely shining trophy that is up for grabs for this afternoon's game. But just quickly, just your final thoughts, Steve, on just this overall 3 weeks of competition, this remarkable tournament. I've got to say, I've done some, had some amazing experiences around the world through commentary, through sport, but this is right up there. Man, have I been impressed.
Oh, absolutely. We came into this tournament not sure knowing what to expect, but we've been pleasantly surprised by the standard, and it's sad that it's coming to an end. But listen, you're going to go home with a team that's going to be smiling a bit more than the other team. So it's been fantastic.
And the nice thing is today we're going to see Fiji in their traditional colours of white and black. The Australians, well, they're going to be in their famous green and gold. Two contrasting styles. Don't go away, folks. This is going to be fast. This is going to be furious. This is going to be women's rugby at its best. Following that, well, history beckons for two of the powerhouses of world rugby. New Zealand will take on France. The Defence Ferns take on the mighty Europe. Live here across Pacifica Television and through our live stream.
Here we go on field one. We've got Fiji taking the field as well as Australia. This is the bronze final, kicking off at 1100. Once again, can we please be upstanding for the national anthem?
As they make their way to the halfway line here on the number one ground at College Rifles in Remuera. It's a very good Fijian team on paper, a team that hasn't had a lot of changes. Keep an eye on the very impressive first five in anime. Plenty of pace out wide with the likes of Salita Wonga, their fullback. But up front, it's the likes of Toga Koi and Wakolo who will look to try and set the platform and let loose their very good loose forward trio of Vokoto, Vuda and Siata.
Australian coach Brian Hudson has made a couple of strategic changes to this Australian team, which will be led up front there by the lively hooker Ella Hooper. Look out for Denny Ross and, of course, hard-working flanker Zara Lee, who's been a star for this Australian side. A couple of little changes in the back line where he's pushed regular captain Sarah Reardon out to second five, and Brooke McManus coming in the first five jersey for the Australians.
And we are underway from the kickoff, a short kickoff taken by Annie May for Fiji, but just a knock on, so looking to try and contest, looking to try and win this early battle. And this will be interesting. First up, Steve Harris, a first look at two forward packs who will have parity at set piece.
Yeah, that Fijian little row looking especially athletic there in the number 24 jersey for Fiji. It looks like it's Uli Kadavu.
Yeah, we've had a couple of jersey number changes. So, halfback for the Australians, and boy, she's classy too. Is Terry Ann Ellis been a real star, but the Fiji just monsters this Australian scrum. First time up, and immediately the penalty goes their way. Well, that'll be concerning for the Australian coaching staff.
It certainly will be. Tonga and Awakolo and Koi in the front row. Well, they get the early points advantage in that scrum, which was impressive.
Well, now we'll get to have a look at the second part of the set piece, the line out, what we have traditionally seen with the Fijians. Maybe surprised to see them go towards the front, but jumping two for the Australians, and what a wonderful player she is, Zara Lee, tall with the blonde hair and the ponytail at the front, and she does contest, and immediately the turnover from the line out. Now the Australians need to just try and straighten it up, running a little bit too laterally, get their support play there, and come out to the left hand side. Fiji in defence up quickly, looking about trying to bring Reardon in there at second 5-8. Well, they did it. She just couldn't hold on to it. And suddenly, turnover back towards Fiji. Fiji is looking to drive up the middle. Good tackle being made by Kira Burke, the number seven, the open side for the Australians. But they look to go one or two. Just one off the ruck at the moment. Set it up nicely, the Fijians. Slow ball low, slow ruck ball. And that moment of hesitation. Knock on. So early in this game, nerves from both sides.
Yeah, the official going back to the original knock-on from Reardon, but a good strong carry from Carolina Vuda, but just a look coming up with a little bit of mistake at the wrong time. As we look at the replay, there's the pass to Reardon, a little bit high for the Aussie skipper, had to reach up, couldn't quite get the hands in the right place, and Fiji not taking advantage of that turnover.
Yeah, number 13 there for Fiji, Numbuta, big powerful runner. Well, for the Australians, they just need to make their first up tackles. They just cannot allow this Fijian team to get good ruck speed and continue to bring in their big runners. Good scrum again. This is much better from Australia. Made that adjustment. Now it is Fiji. Beats one, beats two. Good run coming from the left wing. Kotawanga back inside to Annie May, their first five. Now the scrum half, Kotabavalu, looking to straight. Good defence from the Australians. That remarkable player again that we have talked about so often, involved in that tackle, Denny Ross. But to the short side, beats one. Player not brought to ground. They're going to need to go lower, the Australians, if they're to stop the size of this Fijian team. And so first scoring opportunity for Fiji. They look to go through their forwards, try to go up through the middle, but held up. Tried to go up through Noroketi. They pick and go again. Possible knock on in there. And they do award the try. So the first try goes the way of Fiji. And it is their tight head prop, Miriani Marama Wankolo, who scores the first try, and it's Fiji 5, Australia 0. Well, Australia, they've got to make their tackles. They've got to put their players on the ground, just going a little bit too high. And there's through that, Fiji just getting that full momentum across the advantage line.
Well, no question, the Fijian front row have come out of the blocks at set piece time, and a couple of good features in that particular try. Wankolo with a very good carry. She actually featured a little bit early, got them over the advantage line through the dummy, and ironically, it would be Wankolo who would finish off that try from close range. So outstanding work from the low numbers in the Fijian team.
Yeah, Australia, I'd like to see them play more of a kicking game. They're going to have to play some territory here. They're going to need to want to play Fiji in their own half. They do challenge the conversion, but the conversion is successful. It is now Fiji leading Australia 7-0 in this third and fourth playoff, the very first ever International Defence Force rugby competition. So Australia get play back underway. They go with the deep kickoff. Fiji happy to let it bounce. They'll bring it back through their very impressive forward, Saleta Wanga. And Wanga finally brought to ground by Yolanda Forsyth, wearing the number four, playing it lock today for the Australians. And Fiji now kicking. And now Sarah Redden, their captain, looking to try and take control here. Big tackle, though, coming from Nambura. Denny Ross, acting as the runner, takes it hard into contact. It's good play from the Australians, but still just struggling to really make any inroads into this Fijian defence. As a wee look, the Australian, I think that might be Gabriel, no, it is Lydia Kavala. And it's into touch. Fact. Referee says no penalty. Hands in the ruck there, so Australia chance now to kick and kick deep and play the Fijians for the first time inside their own 22.
Interestingly enough, that kick there being taken by Sarah Redden. She pushes it down, doesn't get a lot of ground from the Fijian penalty. Just a little bit unlucky on that occasion, Fiji. Tackler.
Well, turn over to Fiji, so they contested it. But that might just have gone in the favour of the Australians. So they will get the line out, and they've gained an extra 5 metres in that. Good crowd here in at College Rifles. Expecting to get bigger as the afternoon does go on. So they call a short line out, the Australians. Don't get the throw right though. Now Fiji come away with it. Can they break it out from their own 22? Happy to play the big long cutout pass. No real momentum in it. Steps off 1 foot. Lovely tackle. That is brilliant from the Australian, Yana Zak. We know how good a tackler she is. A match saver against the UK, which really probably put them in this position in this tournament. Lovely little offload chance now. Now Fiji having to get back under pressure for the first time. That is better play, using that short side nicely.
Yeah, Fiji looking to play the game at pace from the turnover, but gee, some nice work there from the skipper. Zara Lee, I think it was, she got over the ball and just out on the wing. We've seen how good defensively she's been, Jana Zak. But on that occasion, taking it to touch herself. Not a lot of arms in that tackle, I've got to say.
So the hooker for Fiji is Isabella Coy. Fiji go to their number 24. Don't quite have a name for her at the moment. I do apologise for that, but not straight into the line out. Attacking opportunity for this Australian team. Alice to feed the scrum. And come to Kavala off the back, but good scrum coming. Forces the knock on. Boy, gonna have to really focus on scrum time and set piece, the Australians. They've had parity a couple of times, but Fijians just almost walking straight over the top.
Yeah, good pressure from the Fijian team. They've started well in this facet. Australia need to sort that out. Kavua with the slight knock on.
It's hard, isn't it, when you're going backwards. But they need to involve Kavua. They need to bring her in. You know, second, third phase user. Fiji very good, though. They're not committing a lot of numbers to the breakdown, so it's allowing them that opportunity to set up around the fringes. And now they'll come out to their right-hand side and looking to little chip kick, very Fijian, and the way they play this can be dangerous. But boy, if it comes off, they can score from anywhere, but they turn it over. And now Alice has a little dart from halfback. Good play here from the Australians. Looking for quick ruck ball. They find it through the number seven, Kira Burke. Brought to ground though. Alice, Kavua. Oh, just ripped away though. That's a good tackle coming from their outside centre, Nambura. This time, their halfback, Kotobavalu, brought to ground. They look to kick the charge down. Opportunity for Australia. Can they get there? They can. And try to the Australians. Try to the Australians. And suddenly, they're back in it. Well, the charge down came very... ever international defence rugby competition final between the might of New Zealand and the might of France. It should be an absolute beauty as this game is quickly becoming. So Alice for halfback for Australia from the kickoff. Oh, big tackle coming, but she's just such a robust player. Jenny Ross, they do kick. So different option being taken from the Australians, but nicely picked up by Namothat. So continuing to take the ball into contact. A pass that didn't need to be made, but referee says no, knock on. So Fiji, just sometimes it's decision making under pressure, Stephen, knowing when to pass, knowing when to perhaps go to ground.
Yeah, good result for Australia in the end, because the chase probably wasn't as good as it was. There was a good follow up there from the lock, Yolanda Forsyth, who just stopped a bit of momentum. And Australia just putting enough pressure at breakdown to get the scrum.
Yeah, a lot to like about their locking combination for Australia. Denny Ross, Yolanda Forsyth. Ross in the 5 jersey, Forsyth in the 4. Now, do they look to kick here, Steve? Do they look to go to Brooke McManus? Another big scrum coming, and tight head. You don't see that very often, but the Fijians have been good. Regather, happy to go back in. Australian tacklers finally bring the Fijian right wing. Namothat to ground. This time, knock on, but the scrum feed will go the way of Fiji. It's got to be a concern still, set in piece for Australia, scrum time.
Oh, very, very much so, and it's just the nature of the way that they're getting pushed back. Really important, as we see the replay there, just the mistake coming from that player in the 24 jersey. We're doing our best to get that name for you in a moment, but... referee says that knock-on came from an Australian player in the rip.
be one of the two locks, isn't it? Is it Willia Kadavu or Doreen Norokete? Halfback for Fiji is Kotapavalu, and he may at first 5'8". They've split their back line left and right, though. Kotapavalu gets it out, does find Anime. Oh, a lovely little pass back on the inside, brings the right wing in, superb play. Now the Fijian flyer, the fullback, Wonga. Oh, monstered in a huge tackle. Does the ball go forward off that? Well, how big is that tackle in the context of this match? That's one area where the Australians have simply been superb. Was that once again Yana Zak? Wouldn't surprise me if it was.
Oh, I tell you what, if we watch the replay there, that's Wonga in space, just looking around, but she got no time to get that pass away because that was a thumping tackle there by Jana Zak. I tell you what, she might be looking for a contract in the women's NRL at this rate.
We saw a match-saving tackle, didn't we, that she made against the United Kingdom, which allowed really Australia to win that game. But now, big, big chance here for Australia. They want to get this in, get it underneath the hooker's foot, get it out quickly, and look maybe to just either go off the back of the scrum through. A brilliant Lydia Kavala, or do they go to their fly half, McManus? Another big scrum coming, and they'll walk straight back over it this time, however. Number one angling in, so penalty goes the way. Goes the way of Australia. So we just have confirmed too that number 24 on the field is Ulia Kadavu. And you can see Kadavu, the tall figure there at the front of the line out. Now don't be surprised to see the Australians go straight to Denny Ross. But Fiji pick it up. Big busting run coming from Wakolo. A little bit untidy at the breakdown, but they can still come away with it. Fiji go through this time. Narakete. Referee says that went backwards. They've got numbers. Another big tackle needs to be made. They've got to make their tackles. That's simply numbers here. Cuts back inside. Another big tackle. Oh, that is superb this time from Kavala. Well, when it needed to be made, Lydia Kavala, the number eight, ranging out wide, the complete footballer.
Yep, Fiji on this occasion, spreading the ball wide. Just wonder though, if they just needed to straighten that. Wonga flicked it out to that impressive winger, Namathoe, coming in for her first start.
And now, Fiji, take it quickly. Referee says no. Has that try been awarded, has it? Thought I heard a whistle in the background. Knock on though, knock on. Well, sometimes you've just got to put the ball down when you're over the line. I might have heard a whistle prior to that, and that's fact from the game going on, which is the plate final between Tonga and the United Kingdom. Let's just have another look at the replay here.
Yeah, off that quick line out. Good offload there from the number five, Ului Kadavu. She finds the tight head prop, Wakolo.
And it was Alice, the halfback that came in and disrupted it. But chance now, how do the Australians combat this very good Fijian scrum? Alice just needs to get this, needs to be a little bit cheeky. Referee on the other side. I don't know, do you throw it under the second rower's foot? Yeah. Better scrum. It's coming quickly. Fiji, Australia will get away with it. Alice, happy to take it. She beats one, she beats two. Brilliant from Alice. Now, does she have any support? The support's still not there. Up over to the halfway line. And the Fijians get there. The cleaners for Australia arrive now quickly. They'll come out to the right-hand side, the Australians. They look to take it straight back in to the middle of the forwards. Happy to take it into contact. Once again, through Kira Burke. She's been good today, the open side for the Australians. Good bit of fetching, though, from the Fijian for Koto. But referee says, no, Australia still have the rights. So Ellis asking for more. Do they bring in Redden here? Their captain, Redden there, looking to maybe for that inside ball, running on the shoulder of the ball carrier. The hooker, Ella Hooper. Ella Hopper. Oh, good defence again from Ulia Kadavu. Fiji's just got to watch being up offside. Another barnstorming run coming from Kavawa. And just that little bit of a knock on, and that is pressure. Well, Australia, though, got themselves out of trouble there. And starting to play with some real enterprise. And that's good from the Australians. And just have a look at Kavawa here.
Yeah, just the last bit of this play goes to ground. And Fijian player looked like the seven came in from the side. Just saw a sneaky little hand go in there as well from the pass from Ellis, and it was dipping, but should have been taken. But I'll tell you what, that was some run from the halfback, Terry Ann Ellis.
Good player, Ellis. Really good player. Again, was, I think, the difference when they played the United Kingdom. But what it's showing is that you can break this very good Fiji in defence. But Fiji will be disappointed that Wakolo didn't score the try. And who was it that prevented it? Again, Ellis. Very much the halfback of the tournament, in my opinion. Now, big barnstorming run coming up from the loose forward. Siata for Fiji. But not getting there, the Fijians. They finally arrive now. Another big, heavy run into contact for the Fijian forwards. Smashed. Notoketi. Good defence from Australia. Surveying their options, the Fijians. They tend to go a little bit more down the short side. Another big barnstorming run coming from Wakolo, the tight head prop. Slow though. Give Australia plenty of chance to get up strong in defence. This time that was Maisie Stephen in the 29 jersey for the Australians. But it's still Fiji. Now they look for something different. They look to bring in their speedsters. Good kick, good tactical kick. Nice change from the Fiji and showing plenty of vision. Hoping that bounce might have just set up Namothat in the corner. But runs into touch.
Yeah, Annie May with the kick option on that occasion. I think she would have liked to have that kick to have stayed in play. All the nets playing the field position game are Fiji.
I'll expect them to go to Denny Ross at the front of the line out. No, over the top this time. Oh, smashed though. Great tackle coming from Vura, the open side for Fiji. And turnover possession. No, Australia do come away with it. Thought they might have turned it over. Through Forsyth. Calling for a penalty, Australia, and they do get it this time. Sarah Reardon takes the quick tap. Fiji not back the 10th. Surely must be playing under advantage. We talked about bringing Reardon in. She needs to have an impact. But loses the ball in contact. And referee says, we'll come back. We'll play the penalty. So quick thinking from the captain, Reardon. You talked about her needing to be more involved prior to this game. She's really injecting herself into this. She's setting the standards. She's setting the tone. Follow me. Follow me.
Yeah, playing more like a second five. Just tried to get free the hands up, but it just needed to be a little bit higher. So there was a little bit of space out there. But it's good to see the Australians stringing a bit together.
Great kick. Well, I still think they'll go to Ross. Number five there, the tall figure. They've called for the shortened line out. They do this time, but go over the back again. Fiji. Another area for Australia that's been disappointing. And that is line-out time. Fiji in through Wakolo. Back up through Notoketi. Taken to ground eventually. So Fiji chance here. Good defence from the Australians. But ball carrier is Siata. Finally goes to ground. And now Annie May looking to kick. That really just kicks into no man's land. Chance now for the Australians to break out. Oh, big tackle coming, but really good from Sarah Ogden. Beats one, eventually taken to ground. Ellis, Reardon, long cutout pass. They've got numbers if they can shift it, but happy to straighten it up. But got to get their cleaners in. Got to support the ball carry, Australia. A little bit more urgency. And up offside the Fijian, so Australia under advantage. High tackle, in fact, is the call. What I do like about the referee, what I do like about this tournament, Steve, not we're going to see it now, is the quick taps that are taken from penalties. There's nothing pedantic about you having to be right exactly on the mark that I think sometimes slows down the men's game. They do take it quickly up through their hooker, Ella Hopper. Hopper eventually is tackled. Ellis now comes out to the right. Not a great pass. Reardon beats one. Decides to pass. They'll cut back inside. Nope. Happy to reset. And now Kavoa. They know the danger she brings. Much better ruck speed here from the Australians. The fetches for Fiji get there. What does the referee say? Who's got the rights here? Well, I think Australia. Oh, I think Australia lucky there. I think Fiji very unlucky. Quick tap here from Ellis. Fiji not back the 10. Playing still under advantage. They beat one, beats two. A little bit loose from the Australians, but they'll come back. Well, Stephen Harris, feel a little bit for Fiji then. Felt they did have their cleaners on their feet, that they perhaps had rights.
Yeah, there's been the last two penalties, I've got to say, that have gone against Fiji. Just a little bit unlucky, but I suppose the official is right there. And he's able to talk to the players or just, you know, educate them at that time. But Australia, to give them a bit of credit, catching Fiji out with these quick taps.
Namortha is the player that has been spoken to. It's a real chance here for Fiji, or for Australia, through Ellis. What a turnaround from the first game that these two teams played, where Fiji put 60-odd points on this Australian team. They decide to tap and go quickly. Happy to take it into contact. Good busting run coming from Ella Hopper. She's been good today. Kavoa arrives. Ellis asking Fiji, this time off their feet, if they turned it over the Fijians. Just waiting for the call here. And scrum to Fiji.
What's he saying? Looks like he's saying that maybe Fiji knocked it on in the breakdown.
Yeah, I'd like to just have a look at that if we can.
Although I don't think Fiji will be too displeased with that, given the way their tight five has started.
Let's just have a look here, Stephen Harris.
There's the run by Hopper. Been an impressive start for the hooker. Runs into contact. Looks like she actually lost it there, but it was stripped by the Fijian player. And that Fijian player going off her feet. A little bit fortunate because you can't play the ball while it's on the ground. You can see Australian skipper Sarah Reardon with their hands in the air. We seem to see a lot of that these days.
We don't, don't envy being a referee. I always say it's not the referees, it's the subjectivity of the rules. Fiji, another big scrum coming. You just sense the penalty. So be interested to know what that ruling's for too. And a little bit of back chat, and they've been brutal on that as well. And now the quick tap from the Australians. Brilliant play coming from Kira Burke. Smart thinking from the Australians. They've got numbers if they can get it out to the left. Ellis, the big long cutout pass. Surely they must score. They do. That is a very, very good try. Smart thinking from the Australians. Well, they just simply love to play it at pace. And just like that, Australia now go out to a 10-7 lead.
Yeah, discipline proving very, very costly for the Fijians once again. Quick tap from the penalty. Burke, she's been heavily involved in the first 25 minutes or so. It's taken in the tackle, and once again, great vision there from the very impressive Terri-Ann Ellis. Finds, look like it's the number 15 jersey of Sarah Ogden. She goes in for her first try of the tournament.
Yeah, still, I don't know, just felt that Fiji have might just been on the end of a couple of tough calls. But these conversions are going to be really important. So it will be Ella Hopper. When was the last time you saw the player in the position of hooker being the goal kicker? Remember a time even in the men's game?
Yep, a gentleman by the name of Steve Watt for Auckland back in the 70s, for those who were born back then.
God, you brought up Bastille Day earlier today, Steve. We're going back to 1978, was it? The French beat the All Blacks at Eden Park on Bastille Day?
Yes.
So, 10-7. Australia leading Fiji. Third and fourth playoff. Good crowd starting to build as we do count down to that first ever final set to go at 1 o'clock between the might of New Zealand and the powerhouse that is France. History-making day.
Been a good contest, hasn't it? We can see the improvement from both of these sides. You know, what I'm liking about Australia, their ball is very, very quick. I think for Fiji, I think they've got to put the ball through the hands. I think they've
I like the way the Fijians, though, they're bringing their runners in, aren't they? They're creating that space, they're creating the channels. They're not afraid to have the runners coming in and off the shoulder, but, yeah, just need to maybe rely on a bit of individual brilliance. Good start from the kickoff. Australia will be disappointed by that. How often do we see you score the try from the kickoff, you don't exit?
Yeah,
and it's a trait that every coach, every team, what frustrates the coaches, we've done all the good work, now suddenly we find ourselves back under pressure. So they'll look to go to Ulia Kadavu at the front of the line out. They go over the back. Referee says play on. It's a chance here. You talk about individual brilliance. Now straightens it back up as Nataketi. Good defence from the Australians. Getting up nice and flat now. A little bit of an overlap here. Do need to make the tackle. Beats one, beats two. Cuts back on the inside. We talked about individual brilliance, but we've seen it this time. And Fiji score a very, very good try, really, from nothing. Australia did so much of the good work. Got up nice and flat in defence, but just simply didn't have the numbers out wide. And that just created the overlap.
Well, a little bit ironic. We just spoke about Fiji moving the ball through the hands. Each player, nice draw and pass we're seeing. It comes into the hands of the big, looks like the tall right winger, Kurawanga. Steps on the inside. Finds a gap through the middle. Too good. Touches it down under the sticks, a little bit unceremoniously, but gets the job done.
And the conversion is successful, and it is now Fiji 14-10. We talk about it, the exit from the kickoff. Australia did all the good work from the kickoff, found themselves under pressure, and you cannot leave the door slightly ajar for this very good Fijian team. Lesson for everybody watching it. It's about concentration, it's about the little things, it's about set piece, and I will include kickoff as part of that.
It was great to see Fiji from their point of view, moving the ball through the hands, simple drawing and passing, and a good finish to boot.
Now, they get back underway, the Fijians, and again, they're loving to use the white lines, don't they? Pass goes back on the inside, but nicely picked up once again by Kavoa. Been everywhere today, Ellis. Big blockbusting run from Denny Ross. Ellis again, this is good. Quick ruck speed from the Australians. Big tackle coming. Get in there quickly again, Ellis. Trying to draw and run this Fijian team around. Maybe they back their fitness, perhaps. Don't underestimate that with 20 minutes to go. Ellis again. This time the Fijian defence up very, very flat. Referee says that's okay. And now they do kick. Good play from Ellis. Now, the chase needs to be good because the very impressive fullback, Salita Wanga. And Wanga, though, tackled nicely. And from that kick, from the base of the scrum, Ellis, she was also the chaser, made the tackle. What a player. Big moments can define a game. And at the moment, it is their very good halfback, Ellis, who is creating plenty of opportunity for Australia.
Well, it's taken a few rounds for these teams to work out that the kick is a very, very good attacking weapon. And on this occasion, some good pressure and a good chase. I think it may have actually came from the halfback herself, chasing her own kick. And she picks up the spoils.
Now off the back, Kavoa. Happy to go tight. Annie May with the tackle, but not high, so they're still continuing to get through. Kavala continues to march towards the line. The Australians get there. Good defence coming from Fiji. Do they have rights? Can they turn it over? No, they can't. Comes back through Ellis. Straight up through Hopper. Driving towards the line. Reardon calling for it in the number 12 jersey. Lovely hold up. They must go in here. Perhaps she should have gone herself. They drop it over the line, and that is disappointing for the Australians. But I think they might come back. They might be under penalty advantage. But boy, I just wonder whether Reardon should have gone on her own.
Yeah, unselfish. But I think she needed to be selfish on this occasion.
They take the quick tap. 3 metres short of the line, the Australians. Ellis will go to a one-off runners. Great tackle from Fiji. Brilliant that time from Mokolo. The little step. She can get the ball down. She can. And you know it. Who's the try scorer? Well, we've mentioned her name all day. Of course, it has to be the very classy halfback, the brilliant, brilliant Tyrianne Ellis. What a player.
Well, is there nothing she can do? She can run from long range. She can run from short range. On this occasion, she supports her skipper, gets driven back, came to this right-hand side, looked a pass, the show and go. Thanks for coming. I'll take 5 points right there.
Well, settle back, ladies and gentlemen. We talked about just how close this might be. It's living up to its billing. It is 15-14 conversion to come. And conversion unsuccessful. Score remains 15-14. Now, from the kickoff, Australia need to exit here. Need to address this area. We talk about sport. Well, it comes down to less than 0.001% of performance. Some nights the difference between a good sleep and a bad sleep, or I'm going to suggest the ability to receive the kickoff and turn that into some sort of advantage. So Annie May gets play back underway. Nice high kickoff too. They're doing it well, the Fijians, aren't they? Making sure that the kickoffs are contestable this time. Not really going their way, but they're putting themselves in the contest. They're not really playing percentage football. They want to put the Australians under pressure.
Yeah, unlucky for the Fijians on that occasion. Great kickoff, gave the chasers plenty of time to get under the ball, but you do need a second tier covering those sort of tap backs.
Now this time they've rearranged their line out. They do go back, they find Denny Ross. Good bustling run coming from their centre, Whitmore. Kavala always makes metres, takes three to tackle her this time. Ellis. First time, Yolanda Forsyth takes the ball back into heavy contact. Looks, goes down the short side. Now Kavara again. This time, they do take it to ground quickly. Really good tackle coming from the second 5'8 from Fiji. Teraguthi. Ross. Ellis. Reardon. Cut out pass. Doesn't find her intended receiver though. And there is a knock on, but lots of good work, lots to admire from this Australian team. Fiji, I think they just need to throw it round here, don't they, Steve?
Oh, absolutely. As we see the replay, Reardon, this occasion, she really didn't look to where she was passing. There were a couple of runners there. Hopper was in a bit of a hole, but a couple of players getting in the way.
Yeah, number 17. Sarah Hume, so replacement prop forward. And I wonder whether they've made that replacement, Steve. We didn't see that happen, just to try and strengthen up at scrum time, because they have been disappointing. Seven there is Kira Burke.
Looks like Hume's gone onto that tight head side of the scrum,
which means that we've seen Nicole King possibly leave the field. So the halfback to feed the scrum for Fiji. Kotabavalu. Ball goes in. A much better scrum from the Australians. Annie May looks to kick. Can she find touch though? Australian scramble back. The bounce of the ball, and this is where Fiji are so dangerous. One on one, beats one. Their tackle comes from Ellis, but too good. Annie May, she should, does she? Yes, she does. Can she get the ball down? No, she can't. Superb tackle once again from the Australians. Well, that is simply superb, I think, this time. But they step inside. Do they have the numbers? Scrambling defence from the Australians. Stand up, Australia. That is superb. Fiji. They'll get the penalty, though. They'll get the penalty. Surprise. Must have been very, very close to a penalty try. Must have been very close to a penalty try. And it will be the lock for Australia. Yolanda Forsyth. Let's just go back. Have a look at this. Wow, Annie May with the kick. The bounce of the ball. Superb run coming from Nambura.
Yeah, it looked like she'll go all the way. But a great haul, a run there from Hall. And look at this covered defence. Was that Jana Zak again with another try-saving tackle. Well, outstanding. But once again, Fiji drive towards the line, but a couple of those Australian players.
Yep, got to be careful here, Fiji. And penalty goes the way of the Australians now. So, sealing off is the call. Redden will take the quick tap. Fiji got to be back there 10. They'll back themselves here. They've got numbers, the Australians. Remember, they are a player down at the moment. Oh, lovely little pass. Superb. They bring in that wonderful right wing, Zach, who's just been involved at the other end defensively. But good defence coming from Fiji. They slow it down. Australia now looking to try and straighten it back up. Go nowhere. Another big tackle coming from Ulukadavu. Getting up nice and flat, but offside now. This is where discipline's going to be important. They'll take the tap quickly, Alice. They do. And look to run at those players that haven't retreated the 10. Still back under advantage. Good play from the number 23 for Australia. The fly half, Brooke McManus, eventually goes to ground. At what point do they bring in Kavoa? Fiji got to be careful here now. Yeah, a lot of penalties away.
Yeah, just a bit unlucky. Hopefully we'll see a replay of that. She just had another little to get it. I thought the first time she was actually okay, but she had another crack at it, and that's what he's got her for. If we look at the replay again, it's that McManus who goes to ground. Here's the player, the big number five over it, as Australia takes a quick tap.
Yeah, and this is Lydia Kavar. We talked about bringing her in, and they've decided to just bring her in off the quick tap. Forget scrum time. We think we can muscle this Fiji. Now, Reardon. Better pass, finds Hopper. Hopper looks to straighten, ripped away though by the very impressive Fijian number 8, Siata. And now does Fiji find themselves inside their own 22? Do they look to run? Annie May, she's been successful with the kick. The Australians made the adjustment, they do. Oh, just again, I think it might have been. Yeah, their fullback. So Zira Ogden wasn't able to collect the high ball, but they do play on through their blindside flanker, Zara Lee, their vice captain. Fiji looking to try and walk over it. They'll come back through Alice. Reardon now happy to kick. Good enterprise, but taken comfortably by Nambura. Nambura, support does arrive for Fiji. I think number 8 is Siata. Happy to go 2 off the ruck this time. But good defence from the Australians. Kira Burke. Good run from the Fijian forwards. Great to see ball carrying front rowers. Been very good all day, not a kitty. Every time she gets it, she gets across the advantage line, somewhat unorthodox. Mm. Australians read it nicely, got up in defence, get straight back to their feet. But Fiji retain possession. Another big barnstorming run. This time their loose head, Tonga. This is where they are dangerous. A little bit of a wayward pass, referee says does play on. Nambura wrapped up. Another good tackle from Ella Hopper. But too high is the call. Now, Fiji And they look to just slow this down, try and slow down the Australian momentum, because it is Australia who have the momentum at the moment.
Gee, there's going to be a few sore bodies. We've seen some great attack, but we've seen some really good hits in this game. On that occasion, Hopper, she went a little bit high, and I think she's come off pretty much second best.
Yeah, well, I tell you what, and they are hurting in terms of aerobically as well. I like to say it, when your heart rate's that high and you're trying to get the oxygen in, it gets to a point where you're almost breathing through your eyelids because you're just looking for any way to get the oxygen in. And it's a cycling terminology, but I think it applies true here. And so they go to the back of the line out, not effective. Kavala will come away with it for Australia. Happy to go to ground. Alice here, she looked to kick off the base. No, she doesn't. She goes back to Sarah Redden. Redden puts it into touch, and that will be half time. And it is Australia leading Fiji by 15 points to 14 in a very, very good contest. Stephen Harris, open, flowing, running rugby. You've got to commend both sides, because what you want as a spectator, what you want for your sport, is to have a product that's engaging, to have a product that is entertaining. Oh,
very much so. Only a point apart at halftime, these two teams, but I've just loved the attitude with both sides have actually gone out. Australia realising they had some initial issues at scrum time, seemed to have sorted it out with a slight change at halftime, but some fantastic tries.
Okay, if you're inside the Fijian camp, what do you think the message is? Where are the areas that they'll be happy with, and what are the areas of improvement?
Oh, listen, I'll start with the improvement side, because it's important that they get their discipline right, giving away far too many penalties at this stage. And I think with Fiji, a little bit panicky, a little bit rushed at times, I'd like to see them hold the ball a little bit more, go into contact, use their bigger forward packs, because that's how effectively they started the game.
Okay, let's go back and bring you some of the highlights of the first half.
Yeah, once again, that front row we just spoke about before with a very, very good start. It's the big tight head, Wakolo. Well, she pretty much started it. Once again, pick and go through the middle is where this Fijian team is very effective once they get their game going. Got a size advantage against this Australian side. And of course, it was Wakolo. But Australia hit back straight away through their very impressive open side flanker, Kira Burke. Fiji with an extra score. Brilliant set piece move from the Fijians, and the fullback, Salita Wonga, getting the offload, didn't amount to a try. And then another opportunity for the Fijians, which they just didn't take. It's the big number three, Wakolo, so impressive, but a great try-saving tackle from Jack. Speaking of impressive, well, this young lady, Terry Ann Ellis, well, she's been impressive in the first 40 minutes. In fact, she's been a standout. Brilliant run from the halfback. It was Kira Burke, another one of the impressive Australian players in the first half. And Ellis just seeing the space on the outside, and it would be the fullback, Ogden, that would finish it off. Unlucky from the conversion. Hop up, been a bit off today. Fijian, the beautiful try themselves. This time it would be the big winger, Paulini Horawanga, finished off a good move, and just to cap off a fine 40 minutes for Terry Ann Ellis from close range. She dots it down.
And so it is at half time, Fiji trailing Australia 15-14. Stephen Harris, let's go inside the Australian camp. What will they be happy about? What will areas they'll be looking to improve? Clearly, set piece possibly being one of them.
Yeah, I think for Australia, just really need more support on the ball carrier, because they obviously want to play a game where they keep moving this Fijian team around, but I just think at times some of their passing has just let them down, haven't quite hit the ball carriers at the right time. They would have been a bit disappointed with their scrum in the first 30-odd minutes. But listen, credit to the Australian Australian head coach, Brian Hudson, for making that change. How often do we see coaches leave it far too long before making that change?
Or making changes for the sake of change, and that can be a danger. That normally happens in the second half when a player is playing well, and then suddenly we go, well, we had set to leave at 63 minutes, so we'll carry through with it. So still nothing in this, but Australia I think Fiji too, you know, winning by such a big margin in the first game, maybe do you come in expecting a similar result and you find yourself leading down by a point in the first half, and what psychological damage does that do to this team?
Yeah, real good points there, Mark. You know, I think for the Australians, I spoke to them pre-game, they were pretty dark on that performance. Mentally, they weren't there, but they're showing today they are there. Fiji probably started in such a way there would have been a lot of confidence from that first up game where they comprehensively beat this Australian side. And they are a side, once they get on a roll and you let them play their style of game, they will run over you. And the passes stick, the scoreboard mounts up very, very quickly. But I like the way that the Australians have actually come back at Fiji in this contest and matched them physically at times, because we've actually seen some pretty big hits. And gee, Zana Jack is a player that we've not really Jana Zach, that is a player that we've not really spoken about, but you could arguably say she's probably come up with the two or three biggest defensive plays of this tournament.
I think the biggest defensive plays of the tournament, I think the best halfback in this competition that we've seen so far is very much the Australian Terry Ann Ellis. How good she been? We see the impressive Lydia Kavar. I think she'd walk into any side. But then you do look also at this Fijian team, the very impressive centre Nambura. She's been quality all day. I mean, Wakolo, Tonga, the loose head, the tight head props for Fiji. And we've seen how dominant they've been at scrum time. So, you know, both sides carry players who, if you're picking a tournament team, I think would have no problem having three or four players in it. As we now will go back underway, really important first 10 minutes for both sides. Both teams will be looking to score points early, and I think if Australia can even get a penalty, so they look to take the 3 points, keep the scoreboard pressure on, keep that pressure ticking over. So play will get back on it. It'll be Australia to kick off. They'll go through Brooke McManus, their first 5-8. Do they look? And so McManus gets play back underway. High kick off, not collected by the Fijian number 8, Siata. And they return it with interest. Now, Sarah Redden, of Māori descent, captain in Australia, looks to go back up through Hopper. Ellis, happy to go one off, finds Lydia Kavala. Happy to go through the hands. Another good player in Zara Leet, vice captain. And now they'll take the quick tap. Ellis will take the quick tap, and she does. Referee says play on. They've been consistent in this area. Got to make sure, though, that she's not running away from her fellow teammates. And that is exactly what did happen. Just simply didn't get their cleaners there. Fiji, too good. Brilliant turnover. Player managed to stay on her feet.
Yeah, the right idea from Australia to play the game at pace, because they've been catching the Fijians out, but on that occasion some great work from one of the Fijian forwards.
But they haven't found touch, and now the Australians run it back up through one of their rangy locks. And beats one, beats two, they continue this time through Maisie Stephen, Ellis. Having a good game out there in the loose. Kira Burke, Redden. Burke again. Good support play coming from Laura Fletcher, the left wing for Australia. Ellis, though, go two off. Back through Zara Lee. Under advantage, the Australians. Kavala, happy to straighten it up. Now, ruck speed important here. A little bit too slow from the Australians. They look to kick. They know they're under advantage. They take the option. But they'll come back for the penalty. So good enterprise from the Australians. Testing the back three of Fiji. At that time, the right wing. Too comfortable under that high ball.
Yeah, Fiji got to be careful. I think they're already under a warning in the late in the first half. The referee had a chat to the Fijian skipper at the time.
Well, Ellis happy to kick, and they will go through Zara Lee. She'll look to run it. looks for the pass back on the inside, decides not to go into contact. They get away with it. Got to be a little bit too clever. Not sure what that penalty's for, unless it was high, because I felt Fiji might have had rights there. They'll come back through Zara Yu, the replacement prop, who's made a big difference at scrum time for the Australians. Now, the brilliant Denny Ross. Absolutely monster, though. Doesn't go far. Fiji not committing numbers to the ruck at the moment. They go back through Lydia Kavawa. She beats one, brought to ground. Now, just another wayward pass from Zara Reardon. Fiji's just getting blown off the park at the moment. Well, not quite sure what that original penalty was for, Stephen Harris.
Oh, I'm assuming it might be originally a high tackle, because I actually thought the Fijian player, once again,
had rights.
Had all the rights, but the official seeing it otherwise.
Let's just have a look here. Oh, that's just a late pass, and then Zara Lee here looking to straighten up. And now, Fiji's surprised they're not kicking. Happy to just tap and go. Kavawa smashes, draws the defenders across to the far side of the park. That now opens up the left side. Now, that's a better pass this time. Got the overlap. Does she look? She cuts back inside, but good tackle coming. Australia still managed to pick it up. Once again through Hopper. Alice again. Darts, goes. Good defence around the fringes this time from the Australian halfback on halfback. Good defence coming from Kotovavalu. Another penalty coming. This time, surely someone's in the bin. Yes. And it is the big, tall right lock, not a Keti. Well, that's a big blow for Fiji, because she has been absolutely superb. Alice starting to look a little bit more like sevens at the moment. Brings in the open side, Burke. She goes to ground. Happy to come down. Kavawa. Good Fiji in defence. Australia not going anywhere. Nicole King in the number three jersey. Looks to try and pick and go. Oh, good defence. Absolutely monstered the Australians this time. And now they look to try and walk over. But Zara Reardon, no real support play there. Cleaners arrive now. Straights back up by Lee. Good straight running from her. Fiji have the rights. They turn it over. No. Referee says play on. Oh, good hands from the Australians. Another penalty. Another penalty goes the way of the Australians. Referee says no, come back. More words to be said to the Fijian captain.
Gee whiz, Fiji can't afford to go another player down.
Right. And this time Kavawa. One, two, the hooker, Hopper. Did she get that down? She did. Australia score the first try of the second half. Out to a 20-14 lead, and it's discipline that's just letting the Fijians down at the moment.
Yeah, little surprised Australia didn't take the scrum with the numerical advantage, but they've had intent to move the ball wide all day, and on that occasion just too many numbers, and Hopper is the recipient.
Well, we talked about it too, isn't it? Yeah. Got to, when a team comes in as favourite, a team's had a 60-point win over you previously, you've got to get in front of them, you've got to put a bit of doubt in their head, you've got to see how they cope with adversity. And now Fiji having a long talk to themselves. They need to score the next try. The thing with the Fijians, they can score from anywhere. And one thing we've seen through the tournament, the times we've covered Fiji, at times they've been outplayed, but when it counts, they get the job done. And how lethal are they, particularly in the last 10 minutes?
Oh, I wouldn't write them off. I think the scoreboard is just a place to put numbers up, Mark, because this team could score tries from anywhere, and they've pulled it out of the fire before.
Hopper pushes the conversion wide. How costly will that be in the context? So,
lead by 6 points, 7 minutes into the second half. Good crowd beginning to build here at College Rifles as we do count down to the final played between New Zealand, the defence ferns, up against the might of France. Chance for women's rugby to create that legacy that France and New Zealand have created on the men's side. Some wonderful finals over the year, the 87 World Cup, the 99 semi-final, of course 2007, we won't talk about that one, Stephen Harris, and then 2011, where many reckon that France might have been a little bit unlucky to lose that World Cup final. And now that rivalry will continue amongst the women. So taken up the Australian centre. That is Whitmore. Haven't seen a lot of Whitmore today. Little knock on. Scrum for Fiji. They need to capitalise here, don't they? One thing, we know how good the defence is from Australia.
Yeah, they haven't had a lot of field position for a very, very long time. So you're dead right. It's important that they hit back. Remembering they are down the player.
You can just see in the background there, 32 points to 6. It is the United Kingdom leading Tonga in the plate final. That game started 10:30 this morning New Zealand time. Currently 12 o'clock, so it must almost be over.
Fiji have rung a change as well. Number 20 coming in on the tight head side of the scrum.
So
good shift there from Mariana Marama Wakolo.
Here for Fiji, who really have dominated at scrum time, to walk over this Australian team. Mind you, Sarah Hume's come on for Australia, made a big, big difference. Now the Fijian scrum, they've got it. Now they look to try and run laterally. They're very good at beating one, beating two. We talk about individual brilliance, a chance to score, and Fiji will go in. And that is the Fijian flair at its best. It's the outside back, the replacement, Lavinia Tinai, who scores. And it is back to a 20 point to 19 with the kick to come, just like that, Stephen Harris.
Oh, what a way to make an impact, and possibly her first touch since she's come on. Basically just held the ball out in front of her like most good centres, beat the one player, had one to beat, came across to the fullback Ogden, too good.
Boy, big kick this one in the context of this match as well. Sides have struggled with the goal kicking. Conversion for Fiji, their impressive centre, Nambura. So, that kick is wayward, you can see that just by the body language. Score remains 20 points to 19. Just under 30 minutes remain in this bronze medal match, this first ever bronze medal match in the International Defence Rugby Competition. We do encourage people to watching this. If you're young and you're not quite sure of the direction you want to take in life, look at the defence forces, look at the services, whether it be the Navy, the Air Force or the Army. Might get yelled at a little bit in the first 10 weeks of training, but I'm sure once you get through that. As we now see another big bustling run coming down the left-hand side of the park. Fiji now starting to cut loose. Good tackle being made. Fiji arrived there, though, quickly. They'll look for good ruck speed. They find it through their very impressive loose head. But Sarah Redden at the other end, the intercept of New Zealand in Māori descent. Can she continue? Can she get towards the try line? She beats one, but taken down by the try scorer, Tinai, who gets back. Tinai gets to her feet. The Australians now arriving. Oh, Tinai just a bit unlucky. She just needed to hold her body weight. And then not rolling away, sealing off the ball. But another quick tap. They go again through the open side. The number 7, Kira Burke, come back.
across the far side, looking to straighten it up, and they'll score this time. They'll score this time, and it goes through their utility replacement and through their number 23. Jessica Henry, possibly.
Oh, wow. We're just seeing the last bit of this try, but you could arguably say it actually started on the 22 from a brilliant run by the replacement, Nainai Bula Male, which broke down Reardon with the intercept. And boy, I think it almost went probably 160 metres mark. Crazy.
Yeah, Reardon just not quite having that pace, did she, against mine? Yeah, she's probably very, very quick. The Fijian is just extraordinarily fast. So sometimes you look a bit slow, but it's only in context of you're running next to an absolute bullet train. Just have
we
a look
here. We see it here. That pass needed to be made straight away. Reardon, though, read it brilliantly. Looked around 60 metres out. We thought she'd go all the way as the cover defence starts descending on it. It was a foot race.
But it's still a great vision, isn't it, from Reardon there, just to be looking for that support, having that ability, saying, where's the cover? Do I have anybody on my inside or outside? Going to have to go the whole way here. She always knew she was going to run down. But she did everything right, running the angles, trying to give her support players some time. But you did feel for Lavinia tonight, who chased down for Fiji, that if she had just managed to stay on her feet, she had rights, Fiji could have turned that over. Now, pressure goes back on Australia from the kickoff. Can they exit out of here? Fiji have been very good through Annie May in terms of high from the kickoff and really putting the receivers, and again, knock on. This time coming from Jenny Ross, goes into the hands of the Fijians, so the advantage being played. Another big blockbusting run, this time coming from Salati Kaibu, replacement prop. Come out through their flanker. Fokoto gets good advantage as well. Annie May coming in, acting as halfback. Fiji just need to slow it down here. Cleaners come in, clean the Australians out. High tackle is the call. Quick tap taken by the Fijians. No. It's been one of the differences, though, hasn't it? Australia have taken the tap quickly.
Yep, you almost get the impression that this will come down to whoever can keep their head, whoever's got the better fitness. Admittedly, you know, we're at the last game of what's been a very good tournament.
Well, Taraguthi.
Fiji keep ringing the changes.
Inside centre is Taraguthi. They'll ask for a scrum, are they? And then look to maybe go one-on-one with their outside backs, and we've seen how dangerous they are, particularly when they go laterally initially and then look to straighten up. So, big call from Fiji in the context of this game. Keep an eye on Siata at the back. In fact, the number 17, I should say now, is Ravuvu. So, on our sheet as a replacement prop, but coming on to play in the loose. So, Kotabavalu with the feed. And it will come off the back. Happy, but got to get there. Get there now. Got to get to that breakdown. Another big busting run from another one of the replacement props, Raluvu. Continues to go, Raluvu. Oh, dominating barnstorming run from Ravulu. Arm goes out. Fiji playing under advantage. Australia up very flat. Taraguthi takes it to ground. Annie May surveys her options, comes down the short side, goes back to another one of their big boppers, Ravulu. Happy to straighten, happy to continue to draw this Australian defence into the contest, take it into contact. Lovely little show and go from the big lock, Soleti Kaibu. Now, they do go out to the short side, looking to try and beat their player one-on-one. Another poor pass. Handling just letting them down. This time, Anna Maria Batti. And they'll come across. They'll play the scrum.
Well, I'm assuming that was a knock-on advantage there from the official, as we see the last bit of this movement. Almost looked like an Australian got a hand in there, but probably just that pass just needed to be made a little bit quicker, because Anna Maria Butty.
Yeah, just felt that they needed maybe just pick and go a little bit more, go one or two phases through their forwards. Their strength is when they're coming out to this right-hand side. Interesting to see, though, that Lavinia Tinai now playing in that 23 jersey outside, moving out onto the right wing as their centre, Nambura. Just waiting for Wonga, their fullback. Love to see her being injected into this Fijian back line. 25 plays 19. Don't go anywhere, folks, because this is far from over. So we've seen Taraguthi now acting as halfback in replacement of Kotobalavu. Oh, good scrum coming from Fiji, driving over the top. No, referee says angling in. And so Dallas takes it quickly. Australia happy at the moment. I wonder how many phases before they do look to kick, do look to clear. And they kick now. Can they find touch? No, they don't. But certainly some distance on the kick. Returning will be Nana Bola Mallet. Mallet smashed in a good tackle from Denny Ross. And now Annie May looks to kick, but picked up by Alice. She has been everywhere. A real danger. Beats one. Beats two. Finally wrapped up. Good tackle coming from Nolaketi. Got to roll away though. The referee says I'm okay, happy with that. And they bring it back through their blindside flanker, Zara Lee. The big barnstorming run from their replacement forward, number 17, Sarah Hume. And now a really good run coming from their hooker, Hopper. Beats one, beats two. Oh, takes you back to the days, doesn't it? Of the likes of the Dane Coles and some of the great All Black hookers. We have the role of hooker has changed. Well, referee says, yep. And I think Fiji had an argument there that perhaps the tackler wasn't releasing. The problem with Fiji is they just weren't on their feet, were they?
No, not at all. But, boy, what a run from Hopper. Showing a bit of pace, running like a centre.
Oh, takes you back to the days of Hicker Reed, the, what they call him, the happy hooker from Nongataha.
Boy, how the role of the hooker has changed in the modern game.
Yeah, these days almost acting in the loose, don't they? At times they love to just hang out there on the wing.
Yeah, once upon a time you had two jobs, throwing the ball into the line out and scrumming.
The next thing that'll happen to those that playing in hooker, particularly in the men's game, you know, the modelling career shortly. Always something set aside for the outside backs and the first five and all the glamour players.
Yeah, they were, with the greatest respect to those who play from 1 to 8, they were never looked upon as the front of magazine, more the back of magazines, Mark.
Yeah, and we're referring to the men's game, clearly. We are referring to the men's game. We do want to emphasise that. So, yeah, I know. I know. God forbid the day our men's hookers are putting hair gel in their hair. And so this is a really, really good move here from the Australians. Keep this scoreboard pressure ticking over. This 3 points will extend it to more than a converted try for Fiji. So Hopper off the penalty, and it is over. 28-19. So good decision making from Sarah Redden, the captain, along with the vice captain Zara Lee. 28-19.
It's an interesting call given that Hopper's been off with her radar today, but that one just stretches outside that try scoring zone. The pressure goes back on Fiji.
Another wayward kick this time. That's what we've talked about. Stephen Harris just can't do that. Must be better at the kickoff, must know how to exit. Frustrating for the coaches, all the good work done at the other end, and suddenly you find yourself immediately back under pressure against a Fijian team who have dominated at scrum time.
Absolutely, if there's one thing that they'll take away from this game, if it doesn't go their way, they'll think about this exit strategy or lack of exit strategy, it's really important no matter what level of rugby you're playing.
So, Fiji, can they hit back immediately? They did earlier from a very similar position. They'll go quickly. And so they will look, Annie mate, looking for the runner to cut back on the inside. Happy to bring it back into contact. Good barnstorming run coming from Vakoto, the blindside flanker for Fiji. Happy to just slow things down. They'll come the short side. Go back again through their big bopper, Raluvu, who has been devastating since coming on. Gained some big meters. Another one of their ball carrying front rows. It might have been their hooker then, Koi. But up offside the Australians. So take the tap quickly. Australia not back. Are they still under advantage? Yes, they are. It's a chance now for Fiji to throw a little bit of caution into the wind here. They're happy to go. One off the ruck, held up over the line. And try is awarded, though. Try is awarded. I thought it might have been held up. But a very good all-round try from Fiji. And that is very, very good. And again, it all comes from the kickoff, Stephen Harris.
Yep, failure to exit your red zone. It's a real key one for anybody playing the game. It's a real killer for a lot of coaches. As we see the replacement player, looks like Nambura, showing some excellent strength to cap off that try. But once again, but good play there from Taguthi with the very, very quick tap. And it's brought Fiji right back into the game.
Also shows the importance of taking that 3 points earlier, because even if they're successful with the conversion here, they'll still find themselves down. Kick coming, just wide though. So 28 plays 24, just a try in it still. Australia hanging on narrowly over the very fast finishing Fiji. Now it comes down to fitness level, now it comes down to the depth of your bench. Individuals will win you games, but a squad will win you a tournament.
It's interesting that you talk about the bench, because thus far Fiji getting great value from their players off the bench. We've already seen the involvement of Raluvu, the replacement tight end prop, but also Male, the outside back, and Tunai already showing some glimpses of what they're capable of.
So play gets back underway. This time Fiji hold it, go the direct run. Good quick play coming from their right wing. Namothat, and he may will kick, somewhat unorthodox, but doesn't find touch. Really good run from the fullback, Sarah Ogden. Ellis finds Hopper. Under advantage again, the Australians, so Fiji up offside. They look to do here, or oh, flat defence. Does the referee say advantage is over? Can't be too many more phases if they don't start to make some serious meters. Another good run coming from the Australian loose forward trio. 17 is Sarah Hume. She's had a big impact since she's come on, both at set piece and around the ground as well. Now Fijians looking to try and hold up the ball carrier. Goes to ground, tackle is called. Ellis finds Hopper. Ross this time gets absolutely smashed by Wakolo. And coming away with it in fact is Raluvu. So turnover to Fiji, and now the penalty. And a little bit of back chat. They'll come back another 10 metres. Well, the defence services, it is about discipline. And so therefore, I reckon they're going to be pretty tough on it. They have been a lovely little bit of a show and go. Good play here from the Fijian forwards, bringing all 15 players into the contest. Now, they do have numbers if they can use it. Beats one, beats two. The brilliance of Fiji. She should go herself. She does. Superb Fijian try. Wow. And Nambura scores. Well, they talked about Jean-Luc Sardinet back in 94. The try from the end of the world when the French beat the All Blacks. That's as good. That is Fijian rugby at its finest. This time, though, remember the name, write it down, because that is superb from Fiji, their big centre, Nambura.
Well, we talk about rugby being a 15-man game. There are at least a dozen sets of hands in this try, but it'll be the number 13 with a brilliant show-and-go. Ivamere Nabura with the finish for Fiji, and it puts Fiji back in front again. And, well, I'll tell you what, they've got their tails up, haven't they?
Well, they're loving this, aren't they? 29-28 Fiji over Australia. 14 minutes remain. What a turnaround from the very first round of this competition. But it's still anybody's game. Conversion not successful, just 1 point in it. Don't go away, folks. I've got a sneaking feeling there's a few more chapters to be written in what could become a bestseller in the history of Defence Force Women's Rugby. Yeah, 65-5 Fiji beat Australia in that first round game. From the kickoff through Annie Mate, they do get away. Fiji, you probably had the better kicking game in terms of territory. They come back for Ogden. Was that a little knock on? No, referee says play on. Now the Australians arrive, but Fiji have rights. No, referee says that's okay. So Clean is finally getting there for Australia. They look to try and straighten up through no one of their replacement players. And not rolling away the tackler. So Ellis will tap quickly. Got to get good body position if you're going to run it, the Fiji in forwards. If you're going to take it into contact, can't be too high. This time, good tackle coming on the replacement player for Australia. Jessica Henry. Back under advantage. Tap it quickly, the Australians. Yeah, big tackle. A little chip over the top, but straight into the hands of the right winger, Namorthak, who returns it with interest. The Australians now scrambling, trying to get back. This is where Fiji are dangerous. Got to stay on the feet, the Australians. Fijians. So, little kick from Ellis, looking to kick, looking to follow it up through. Nicely taken from the second 5-8 for Fiji. Taraguthi. And now Fiji again rampant through their big centre. Surely they've got the numbers. They go on their own. Oh, superb once again. Pass back on the inside. Do they manage to score? No, Australia come away with it. So, good covering defence from the Australians just when it looked like once again Nambura was going to score. And Stephen Harris, was it Yana Zak again? Probably couldn't quite pick it up and shot. But another try-saving tackle.
The official on this occasion, what's he saying? He's saying, Fiji, you're offside, but gee, a blown opportunity. It was a wonderful opportunity for Fiji to maybe have taken this game out of reach, although with 10 minutes to go, who knows? We saw 60 points in the first game, and we're seeing just as many in this game. As we see the centre, Nabura. There you go. She really needed to position the replacement player. She had Bola Male in support.
Well, that defence just demonstrates how much Australia want this. Equally, the defence at the other end is showing just how much the Fijians want it as well. I mean, what a great opportunity for Fiji to get a win over Australia in any form of rugby. Doesn't happen very often, other than sevens. Oh, knock on. And not straight is the call. So they'll come back, scrum Fiji. And they find themselves just inside the Australian 22. So really good attacking opportunity here. Ulia Kadavu still on the field. And the number 23 jersey, 24 jersey. In fact, it's, yep,
24 jersey there, the two locks, alongside Not a Kitty. The blindside flanker is for Koto in the number 6 jersey. Packing down at number 8 is Revolvo. Do we see Revolvo? Interesting to see that Bolamale also setting herself up almost directly behind the halfback here on the short side, Stephen Harris, in the number 21 jersey.
Yeah, well, they've shown they've got some good attacking threats, this Fijian team. Set piece scrum's been going well, so really perfect position for the right to left pass. Well, if you can bring maybe the blindside winger outside the first five, inside the first five, just to hold the defence. Great opportunity for the Fijians.
So, big scrum now for Australia in the context of this match. Good bit of scrum from the Australians. Up offside though, that is the call. Quick tap, they'll go through their second 5-8, beats one, beats two, looks to try and go underneath the sticks, can't get there. Annie May arrives though at first five, bring their runners in, quite can't handle it. This time Nambuta puts it down. So, Australia get away with another one. Can they exit? Go to Alice, their halfback. She can't find touch. It's a kick into no man's land. Fiji can't handle it, though. They'll come back through their big right winger. Namothat finally brought to ground. The cleaners for Fiji arrive. But, boy, I'm not sure about that one, Stephen Harris. Been a little inconsistency at the breakdown. Yeah. Didn't really give Fiji a lot of time, did they?
Not at all. Fiji be a bit disappointed as well. I really thought they should have packed down another scrum.
Well, I felt too, though, that Fiji still had rights, but not the call. See, similar situation. Penalty surely goes the way of Fiji. No. You're saying that, I think the referee's been pretty consistent, pretty good all day. Now, Australia just need to... Oh, they kick early. Good kick too. Doesn't find touch, finds territory. But this is the brilliance of the Fijians. They turn nothing into something and it still goes back under all sorts of pressure. But they get back quickly, the Australians. They'll go through Alice. Does she kick from the base of the ruck? She does. But straight down to the real danger player, Lavinia Tonight. Yeah, happy just to almost taunt the Australian defenders. Oh, but has a wee look. That's just a lack of concentration. That would disappoint the Fijians. However, they're playing it at the right end of the park and there's 6.5 minutes remaining.
Yeah, championship minutes, isn't it, Mark? Just concentration starting to fail. Both of these sides, wasn't the best pass in the world, but it should have been taken. Must admit, it's been an enjoyable contest.
So still time to play. Another big scrum for the Australians. So playing at halfback for Australia is there Alexandra Fulton. Number 1 jersey, so replacement halfback. I wonder what that means for Alice. So where have they got Alice? She's playing at first 5-8, yep. So she's coming at first 5-8. She's replaced Brooke McManus.
Yeah,
I wouldn't want to take her off the park, would you?
No, Alice? You don't take your best player off the park. You know, we saw an example of that NPC final on the weekend.
Mind you, we've seen Lydia Kavoa. I'm not sure Kavoa's on the park for the Australians at the moment, which is a big call, unless she's been injured. Not packing down at number 8. And I think the loose forward cover for the Australians is Madison Lee. Not happy to go to Alice. She looks good though, Alice, doesn't she? And this is good. Get across the advantage line. Good solid run coming from Taylor Whitmore. 19 is Eastwood. Just got to be careful they don't run out of territory here. Want to try and stay in. Don't want to turn possession over through a line out. They'll come back. Happy to go again. Brought to ground in a heavy tackle. Denny Ross. And now Fiji have rights. Referee says play on. Oh, good defence from Fiji coming through, putting all sorts of pressure on this Australian team, and they do force the little error.
Be interesting to see which way the official goes. Well, wow.
I'm not sure how that can be a Fijian scrum.
Well, to me, two questionable turnovers. I realise this commentary is going into Australia as well, but I thought Fiji very unlucky at two breakdowns.
I'd like to have another look here. I felt initially they had rights. Now here, not sure where that knock-on comes.
No, still looking for the knock-on, but...
No, really unlucky, I think, Fiji. We've talked about consistency, haven't we? We've seen a number of times where, you know, we've seen the Australian fetchers arrive very quickly and be given the turnover. And we've seen a couple of times here where I think the Fijian fetchers have got there quickly and not been given it. Mind you, it's easy sitting here, isn't it, watching it on television. The referees get one look at it. Credit to them. I think they've done a really good job throughout this tournament.
So we shouldn't forget what a wonderful job these officials are doing at this tournament.
So 1 point in it. Australia need to do something here. Not a great pass, but Ellis will straighten it back up. Lovely little player. And Fiji this time can't get their fetches. So they go back through their blind side. Sara Lee, their vice captain, looks to try and take control. Also their number eight, their inside back, Michaela Crisp. Smashed again by this very good Fijian defence. Trying to get himself up over the halfway line. Haven't been able to do it. And now, automatically on the back foot. Good bustling run coming from Brooke McManus. So McManus, I think, has moved one out. Gone possibly into second five. Haven't seen Sarah Redden, so I just wonder whether Redden may have left the park. Knock on. Scrum Fiji. Valuable minutes being soaked up here by the Fijians, who lead by a point.
Yeah, really surprised Australia are playing in such a narrow channel with only a couple of minutes to go, because really they need to find some space, get themselves in a position to maybe win this game. Fijian defence has certainly been quite steely in those inside channels, and that's created the turnover.
So now that is just the running clock for us. The referee will be in their own time. So we're not sure whether 2-3 minutes of injury time, whether or not we'll have the hooter at 40 minutes, according to what you're seeing on your screen. So Fiji here. What is the tactic? I just really want to keep Australia in their own 22. Really good scrum. Much better improvement from the Australian scrum. Annie May, happy to control things again. Another, oh, she's a lovely, lovely footballer. That's a superb play. 23 inside to 22. High tackle advantage. So Barty to Tinai, great combination. The penalty does come. And that will be a yellow card for the right wing, Yana Zak, who has been the best tackler in this competition. That one just got away from her a little bit. She's not a malicious player at all. Yeah, just high. And really nothing. No real option for the referee other than yellow. And again, just continuing to soak up valuable time. Fiji will put that into touch. Surprised they just didn't call a scrum. Need to go to the just need to go short here at line out time. We will bring you the medal ceremony following this. They do go to the front of the line out. And now looking to try and just seal a deal here, Fiji. Time up on the clock. Fijians arrive. Looking to just slow it down. Happy to go down the short side.
one of their replacement props. Advances them another 2 metres closer to the try line. Big run coming from Raluvu. They still can't bring Larue down. Now they get him behind a driver towards the line. They're over and try to Fiji. And that'll wrap it all up. It's Fiji 34-28. And what an impact that the likes of Ravuvu and Raluvu have made since coming on. That is superb. And it is the big prop, Seta Waia Raluvu, who scores the try.
Well, we wondered who'd be the team that would keep their heads going into this final quarter. Well, we can answer that question now. It's Fiji, as we see the big carry there from the number 18 for Fiji, who's been very impressive. Raluvu still got her hands on the ball.
Good team try though, wasn't it?
Yeah, rest of the pack getting behind her, and look how delighted they are. Look what it means to this Fijian team.
Well, to get a win over Australia in any 15 man game or 15 woman game. As we now wait for the conversion, that should see the end of it. It'll be Fiji who'll walk away with the bronze medal in this first ever international defence rugby competition. And the conversion looks good. It is successful. It is Fiji who lead 36 points to 28. And the crowd here loving it. And it is all over. And it is Fiji who win the bronze medal, Australia fourth, but boy, a valiant effort after having beaten 65 points to 5 the first time these two teams played each other 2 weeks ago. What a turnaround from the Australians. Plenty to build on, Stephen Harris.
Yes, yes. Well, what is it with this Fijian team? They've been involved in a couple of very, very tight contests and once again have just shown enough nerve to get across the Australians with a late try. But you've got to talk about their impact off the bench. How good was that? And I think at the end of the day, that was the real difference.
Well, Fiji very unlucky not to make the final, losing that semi-final against France 6-5 last minute penalty to France to narrowly win that one. And it's great for Pacifica rugby. And we hope you are enjoying the coverage wherever you are watching this, courtesy of Pacifica Television. Congratulations to Fiji. We will bring you that medal ceremony very shortly. Don't go away, folks, because we are going to bring you the final, which will be between the might of France and New Zealand, the defence fans.
Yeah, some great scenes here at College Rifles Rugby Football Club. Fiji, well, they've been a great addition to this tournament in 2022. This very first Defence Forces rugby tournament. Hopefully it'll be the first of many moving forward as the two teams congratulate each other. We look at some of the tries. This is the first half. Fiji, well, they started the best of the two teams. And it was their tight forwards doing the job. Wakolo, Sierra at the back of the ruck, positions herself nicely. Picks it up, gets the lead drive going. Australia hit back, their very impressive flanker. Kira Burke involved again. And the opportunity for the second try. Ellis with the quick shift out to the left-hand side. Ogden going in for the try. Once again, tit for tat. This occasion, they moved it out to the right-hand side. Very impressive rangy winger, Hurawonga, getting the try. Australia with an extra score. Watching the first side highlights. Kerri-Ann Ellis, well, she's been impressive throughout the tournament. Caps it off with a try in this playoff match. We saw Australia with some good ball movement down this left-hand side. Another impressive of the Australian players. Ella Hooper going in for the try. And then Fiji, well, saw some individual brilliance from this Fijian team, and they got plenty of mileage off their bench in the second half. This occasion, though, it would be Reardon who would pick off that pass. A good read from the Australian skipper, but she got run down. Fiji did well, but it'd be Australia who would be first to recover, and it was McManus in the 23 jersey finding the try line. Fiji, though, great hit back, never gave it away. This probably one of the tries of the tournament. So many players handling. They found Namura so impressive. Got to Ogden, the fullback. Too good, too strong. And here we go. Fiji, they wrap it up. Right on full time. Some wonderful impact. Especially from the replacement prop, Siruwaya Raluvu, as we await on the presentation for third placing. Of course, we saw a good contest on the outer ground between Tonga and the UK. We'll get the final score through to you very, very shortly, how that one played out. But that looked like a tight contest as well. If you've been enjoying this coverage throughout this tournament on Pacifica TV. Of course, myself, Stephen Harris, Mark Watson, been your callers. Certainly been enjoyable, well put together and well run tournament. Tonga and the UK just in picture. Weather's been fantastic throughout during the tournament, probably the best day we've possibly seen in this tournament. Get ready for some of these formalities, remembering we got the big final coming up between France and New Zealand. It's coming up in about 20 minutes time. Remembering New Zealand in pool 8 finished top of the table on 14 points, France on 10, Tonga on 5, and Vanuatu PNG, the combined team, remembering there were 7 teams at this Defence Force tournament. Australia, Fiji, finishing top of the table on 9 points. Australia, 5 points. United Kingdom just picking up their only win in the tournament, but we'll just confirm if they won this final game against the UK.
Kia ora, ladies, that's us. We'll get into today's prize. First of all, we will start with the plate final between Tonga and the UK. Then after that, we'll get into the bronze final with Fiji playing Australia. First of all, I'd like to call up Dame Julie Christie, Chair Rugby World Cup New Zealand, to help present the plate final and the player of the day. So for our player of the day for the UK, we had the right flanker, Bethan Dayton. And for Tonga, we had the fly half, Tonga Tuiaki. And then our 2022 Plate International Rugby Defence Competition winners is the UK. Well done to our UK. Now just get into our bronze medal final. Thank you very much, man. Now I'd like to call up Claire Baird, head of New Zealand Women's Rugby, to help present. For our player of the day for Australia, we had number 22, Lydia Kavoa. And for Fiji, we had number 23, Lavinia Tinai. And our bronze medalists go to Fiji. Thank you. Big round of applause for all four teams out here today on a beautiful tournament. Congratulations, ladies, and enjoy your day. Please stick around for the final happening in 10 minutes. Thank you very much.